want to see teams with a coherent identity playing to their win conditions. Whichever team can pull that off, win, lose, or draw, it should help them moving on to the season.
Well, Papa Smithy, I have some news for you.
I want to see it. Doesn't mean I'm going to see it.
If you want that, this may not be the game for you.
So the first band, Lulu, actually comes out against us, and so taking away one of the most defensive laners in the league. Surprising.
That is, especially because Sossen has played it a couple times this season around Nuclear's Jinx, but they haven't been playing it in their last five. So it does seem a bit curious right there. There is the Thresh onto Ignar. That is not surprising at all. Ignar has been one of the big forces on IM, kind of stepping up for the lane pressure when Tucson hasn't been there to deliver, Sejuani.
Is that three different bands than what we saw in the previous series? So there could really be an interesting pool of champions available. Certainly not going to be the multiple AD carry bands that we saw in the K2 Ulster series.
Yeah, very interesting, but very effective. I think that Sivir ban in the last series was very smart against KT. Now the Ryze, of course, going down. Will the Kalista be the final ban? Do you want Roar to have that champion? Do you have an answer for it? Obviously, Nuclear felt that he did with that Tristana in their last match.
I feel like maybe that'll be a lower priority ban, a bit like how KT Rolster's been happy to give up Kalista to select opponents. If you take confidence in the Tristana pick, it's one of those situations where both of them are auto-attack-based champions in terms of the explosive charge and the rend, especially if you're maxing rend as a Vayne. You just, as a Kalista, you can't 1v1 a Tristana. The direct burst damage from the explosive shot is just too high, so if you're willing to opt into duels, that can really work out for the Tristana play. Of course, have those pushing options as well. Gragas is banned for a second jungle ban, actually, coming out against Catch. So despite not necessarily being high in your maybe tier list of junglers in Korea, it's going to be a really small pool after these two are gone. The top tier junglers are really starting to be pushed out.
That's very true, although the Eve and the Rek'Sai still on the board, so some good options remaining. There is a LeBlanc ban. Kalista gets through. Is IM going to first pick it, however? They could take the Alistar instead for Ignar, and that's what they're going to do.
So there's likes of Varus available. I feel like Rek'Sai is the right choice, especially when Eve is the other consideration, because, of course, the Tremor Sense so strong against the Perma Invis that everyone's able to put together. Waiting to see what else to priority. In terms of mid lane, it's only LeBlanc taken out of the champion pool. Still have the likes of Azir and Cassiopeia, who we notably didn't see at all in the previous series.
Yeah, Frozen, though, loves to pick up that Cassiopeia very early on. It's a champion that he feels quite comfortable on in a variety of matchups and has that big carry potential. So I imagine we'll see Frozen taking that this game. Picking a Hecarim with the Gnar is up, especially Apple, who is known as primarily a Gnar player, is quite dangerous. So I think you go something a little bit different right here. We haven't seen Urgot in a little bit in Korea, but definitely still a viable pickup. And they're going to take the Kalista and the Rek'Sai instead.
So taking the Kalista away. There, it does open up the Tristana matchup. Don't know if Roar is going to pull that out. And there's an insta-lock of the Victor coming through. No Victor in the previous series. Banned against Kuro twice in a row. We already saw the potential of Faker.
It also has been banned very heavily against Frozen. As a reminder, even before Victor was popular, even before Kuro brought him into the professional scene, Frozen was playing a ton of Victor in solo queue. And before the rise of Cassiopeia and Victor, Frozen was getting those champions banned against him quite prominently in the spring season. So now that Victor comes to the fore, and they're going to pair it with a Vayne for Roar. And Roar's Vayne has actually been pretty good. He put up a pretty good stat line in spite of the losses that they suffered against KT.
But when you commit early to Varus Victor, you're talking about two short-range damage champions. Do a lot of damage if the enemy's coming into you, but if you're trying to fight a protracted fight, if there's good kite on the Spenu side, it's very hard to do damage. So if they can control objectives, absolutely a powerful comp. But usually when we see Victor, we see something like Corki, so you can just throw down the gravity field and take turrets. Vayne, not a noted turret taker.
But with a combination of Alistar and Maokai, they could set up very well here for some extremely strong engage from long range. So they'll have those opportunities potentially. They could have taken Rumble as well for a similar ability, but Rumble snapped up by Spenu here. And so will the Nautilus, definitely a great option against Vayne whenever she is picked.
So it's not quite Varus Vayne, but honestly, Victor Vayne, quite a lot of similarities there about damage. Of course, not quite the same long-range poke, but going to be two squishy backline threats that Spender are going to try and find a way to get onto. Not a lot of backline dive when you're talking about a Rumble, but of course the Equalizer will burn through. Do you just go for the Maokai here, or do you actually try and punish what could be potentially a Hecarim? Because honestly, it's crying out for a Hecarim, but with the Rumble locked in, of course, that can't.
Yeah, this is, I think the Maokai definitely going to be the better pick in this composition. Maokai Evelynn would give them some very strong options, though. That's a Jungle Fizz.
Wow. So Doa proclaimed this a few times, and we didn't think it was even a possibility. Mid-Fizz, actually top Fizz, mid-Fizz has been the priority in the world scene, but Jungle Fizz.
Now, well, Tucson known for his unusual picks, of course. I'm sorry to plague your LPL season with his support Irelia. That was his fault. I apologize for that.
Look, the Kalista Irelia still had some synergy going, but yes, suddenly
bad.
We were seeing like three or four Irelia games in support, and it was sad times.
It was. It was dark times for Incredible Miracle as well. They weren't able to pull off wins from the support Irelia, and now we are going to have, ostensibly, that Jungle Fizz. It is a little bit unclear what's happening right here, but they will have great kill pressure in the top lane with Fizz and Maokai together. They have great kill pressure everywhere, in fact.
Frozen's changing over to the Ghost. I actually do like that, because once you've committed to Fizz, they're going to be looking for much more dive than the Victor and Vayne necessarily suggested at the start. So going for a very heavy Snowball jungle. I know how you feel about high-risk Snowball champions. Snowball top lane Smite Fizz is one thing, but Jungle Fizz, basically not a fan of clearing the jungle. Going to be trying to get a lot of lane pressure. CC and top especially is very reliable. I have to think Soul's at a lot of risk if we do see a 1v1.
Yeah, Soul and the Kassadin as well, pre-6. You set up a gravity field right here, and you could be in really big trouble. So how well will Tucson's Jungle Fizz works? Again, a criticism of him as a player has been he doesn't apply the early pressure very well. His gank pathing has not been up to snuff. So is all-inning on a champion that has to pressure the lanes going to be that effective here? I'm not sure, Papa. I have my reservations.
But on the other side of the coin, picking weak lanes like the Kassadin and potentially the Rumble against Maokai, especially with the high gank pressure of Fizz, is a risk. This is definitely a jungler's paradise for Tucson if he does work through those pathing issues. Catch, of course, if you're there for the counter gate, might get a lot of work done too. So we wouldn't have thought it would be an interesting jungle matchup between junglers like Tucson and Catch, but it's really looking like those are the tipping points of this game.
Well, I can't wait to see this Jungle Fizz and how well Tucson will do with it. We're going to get into game one right now. Incredible Miracle versus Spenu.
One very excited fan to see her Spenu team potentially pick up their first win of the season. They're against the Jungle Fizz. I'm waiting for the Observer to show us just what this Fizz is rooting for. You have to think it's going to be basic straight tank out of the jungle. Probably not going to see high ability power numbers. Of course, with the changes to the Seastone Trident, you don't get the on-hit damage. So the jungle clear is slower than when Jungle Fizz was a factor towards maybe patch 5.5 last season. But the Snowball pressure, it's always going to be there when you have a kit like Fizz does.
Yeah, and at least, at the very least, he will have the Cinder Hulk to rely on once he gets it to at least provide some level of AoE damage to burn through the camps. But yes, it will be quite slow.
Actually taking Evelynn-style runes, flat AD and flat ability power to try and clear through the jungle fast. Not really screaming out for a Trinity Force, so probably again going to be the Cinder Hulk into pretty tanky. If Tucson is able to single out Nuclear in the late game, basically occupy all the Kalista's time, maybe that's a pass mark for the Jungle Fizz.
Yeah, and or at the tie up the Kassadin too.
Well, that's harder to do.
It is harder to do. It depends on whether he sticks around in the back line or not to peel, or whether he's going to go all in. And you do have a little bit more opportunity to do that when you're playing a tanky Fizz. Apple will be giving Tucson a hand right here. Starting over at the red buff, and it looks like we are going to have a little bit of a wraparound right here from... Uh-oh, this is a bit of a bait right here. They were actually Nuclear thought there was no one in the topside, so went to freeze the minion wave. Only took an auto for his trouble. Ignar and Roar pushed up pretty far forward in that brush.
Those minion waves got super confused by all the people trying to freeze and come through. So yeah, we have standard lanes, but flipped upside down. The Australian meta coming through in this particular game. Sure. We try not to say it too often because it's such an easy gimme of a joke. But for my OGN debut, a bit of Australian meta. That's the way I like it. A long pause, a long fill, and some Australian meta League of Legends.
And some barbecuing.
That was the other day.
All right, well, Alistar and Vayne, generally a pretty decent lane, but still a lot of threat coming in from the Kalista right here. Or has shown he can hold his own on the Vayne, however. Tucson now moving over to the blue buff just as his third camp. And he is maybe falling behind just in terms of the creeps already when compared to this Rek'Sai. And Frozen just doing some work, keeping that pressure on. But Catch coming around for level 3 gank. No red buff yet, but they're going to go for it. There we go.
Doesn't flash for the unborrow, though, so Frozen able to walk away. Seemed like he was even skeptical whether Sassen had the damage to be able to pick up a kill. They back away. The pressure's on. Blew the ghost, though, so that's something.
Aha. Uh-huh. So a little bit.
Not spotted out, because you would have seen
Yeah, he was. Tremor Sense right there, seeing the fizz right away. And now Vivid on the side, Ignar gonna get a trade with him in the tri-brush, but Catch not gonna be in, well, looks like he will be in a little bit of danger. Tucson really wanting to get this objective. Are they gonna let him have it?
Sassen's gonna be the first person to react. Cheated out of lane, then move back. So this trying to dissuade the Fizz from going into anything. He needs to get away. Catch is super, super low.
Has to this back is away. Really questionable. The problem is they don't have control over the mid lane right now, so you can't really make a good counterplay with the Kassadin onto that buff. And somehow Roar has managed to keep the lane pushed up, so Ignar also just threatening through the side. So three buffs achieved by Tucson's Fizz. Maybe not making the play on the lane, but putting some pressure down on a Catch and punishing him for that gank with just the blue buff that didn't even blow his summoner spell.
And look, we saw Ambition on Lee Sin make similar moves, and of course jungle Fizz, similar to Lee Sin in terms of early pressure. The difference there was that was a Lee Sin jungle versus Sejuani matchup. You normally really respect Rek'Sai as having a lot of early pressure, but it's the reality of picking a Kassadin in the mid lane, even though Kassadin was starting to walk over. Pre-6 is not going to be a factor in any of these skirmishes, so now a jungler like Rek'Sai, who often gets through such a comfortable early game, then can be a gank presence, is falling behind compared to Fizz and lost two camps. He even had his golems, his Krugs, messed up on the top side.
Yeah, this is a pretty strong start for Tucson here, just punishing someone for, I mean, this is a kind of uncharacteristic of Tucson, not really actually reacting very well to what's going on the map, but there, and Catch in a brush. He's level 4, however. No red buff. There's the Chilling Spite, and he's going to Playful Trickster away.
Get out the pink ward as well. So suddenly, Apple looked to be in a potential way to have a lot of defensive information, loses the pink ward, now has no vision whatsoever in the area. So obviously asked for a pink ward to relieve a bit of pressure. Pressure's still there.
So Catch now trying to turn the tables. Doesn't have that level edge any longer. Vivid gets a hook down, but Nuclear gets punted away, and there we have the Pulverize. Not really any follow-up right there from the hook from Vivid.
Two levels into the tumble, probably still going to be the maxing of the Silver Bolts first. Players have different preferences about how many levels they have. If the gravity field registers, there was some kill pressure from Tucson, but doesn't actually activate.
Catch now responding around the mid lane, keeping track of Tucson's Fizz. And some more action than we thought early. A lot of jungler squaring up on each other, seeing if they can get any kind of edge. And Victor just gonna come back into the mid lane. Frozen actually playing with a bit of respect right here. Early Null Magic Mantle alongside that Hextech core, so he wants to continue to trade very aggressively. Bit of an interesting mid lane matchup with all those shields coming in from the Qs.
Sassen gonna go for a very early Abyssal Scepter. I mean, potentially, of course, could just be sitting on the Null Magic Mantle and still building the Rod of Ages. It's pretty common to go for the blasting one first, just for a bit of wave clear. Victor gets a lot of spell rotations out, so you can put multiple points into your force pulse. The extra blasting one can actually help with wave clear and ensure the catch isn't quite as vulnerable to being counter jungled by Tucson, but at least leave himself open to the option, so matching the magic resist choice that Frozen picked up.
Yeah, still double, looks like we are going to see double Abyssal Scepters quite early. That's a pretty big investment in MR, considering that it's just a Maokai, and we have a Vayne in this game. Vivid getting punted around. TP will come in from Spenu, and there's a Rumble suddenly in the lane, but Rumble not laying down that equalizer, so a bit of a pointless teleport into the top side does prevent Vivid from being caught out, but Vivid could have just flashed, and now they have to deal with Apple. Going to have TP advantage in about 2.5 minutes. They really didn't have an opportunity to get a kill there.
And look, it's indicative of their troubles in the late game when it comes to Shot Coin. Their clear communication and teleports has been lacking throughout the whole of this season. Sarsen's starting to step up into damage towards Frozen, but my guess is probably not going to be the Abyssal Scepter anytime soon. Maybe just the Merc Treads Rod of Ages, but whenever you see those two items grouped together, there's always the potential.
Nuclear has some time to go back and get a BF sword. Well, this game could blow wide open depending on what Apple can do in just a couple of minutes right here. Getting an early kill onto that Vayne would be very helpful, not only because she's Vayne, of course, but because of the heavy MR stacking going on for Spenu at the moment, that makes that item power spike that Vayne can hit with the Blade of the Ruined King potentially even more deadly.
I'm excited, Monte Cristo. Look at the jungle enchantment. It's finally the return of Devourer coming through from the Fizz. Devourer jungle Fizz I have not seen since the item was at a much higher power level, and it was Insect of all people playing it. So, look, it's still the potential of full tank, but Devourer Fizz. How do you feel about that, Monty, on a scale of 1 to 10?
I just feel that the power level isn't there any longer to justify the purchase when... And that's also really banking for a long game, which, in my mind, IM already has in the bag. Like, they've got such a powerful composition in the late game with the Victor Maokai Vayne combination that why put yourself at risk when you get more immediate power now for this Fizz? It seems like you're putting yourself in an unnecessary power trough where you're going to have to wait a long time to scale up into some real gold value.
And just on a simple level, why opt into a power trough when there's a Kassadin on the enemy team? And there's always the potential of overtaking the late game. The fish does land, Soul probably gonna fall down here with his base values to work through. Smart lane gank from Tucson. We were talking about whether he get the pathing down. Came in unannounced.
And that was the real dangerous gank that we talked about. Of course, Rumble always vulnerable in the Maokai matchup, but with a champion that has that big time single target burst like Fizz, you have so many options, and now he's sitting on that first blood gold, accelerating presumably that Devourer enchantment with the dagger, and yep, that's what it's gonna be.
That's a Devourer on patch 5.10.
Well, I don't know about this. I do know that Roar having a lot of trouble right there, and that is going to be a teleport in from Apple. They're trying to turn it around. Roar with no HP, but Nuclear having some issues on the outside, and Roar actually going to pop forward with that, trying to sustain a little bit off the wave, and they turn that into a reversal of a kill. And why would you make an all-in when you don't have teleport and the enemy does?
A tale of two teleports. We saw Rumble's teleport to the top lane that kind of opened them up strategically for a move like that. They're going to lose Dragon as well. One teleport led to nothing. The other one from IM led to a kill and a Dragon. That's just symbolic of these two teams.
It was just such a gift from Spenu, not only to have that kill on a risky all-in, but to give away the first dragon as well for what is going to amount to a very small amount of turret damage in the top side as Apple races top. Now, Soul again, because we have staggered teleports this game, will have an opportunity to make a response. But without that dragon there, that TP is a lot less meaningful.
Yeah, Soul can go back, maybe even finish the Abyssal Scepter, probably a few hundred gold away from that. But Catalyst Merc Treads, the kill pressure on the Maokai is basically gone at this point. The early three, level four especially, Maokai is actually in solo kill range as you move to level six. But as the levels come along, the passive starts to get a bit more impactful. The Catalyst and the Merc Treads are completed. See, the issue with the Devourer, though, just to go in a complete segue, is that it means that he wants to farm the jungle more, and he's Fizz. He doesn't farm the jungle. He's maxing the Sea Stone Trident, so he's fiercely melee. The Scuttle Crab, though, he's good at that.
Yeah. Taking it out real quick. Wow, this is such a very interesting build coming in. And
you know interesting means bad, right?
I do. It is a synonymous with bad.
Because, I mean, just let's be simple. You can understand the idea that he's going for, but how many auto attacks do you get off against Rumble, Rek'Sai, Kassadin in a team fight? Realistically, as sticky as Tucson can be, unless he builds a lot of snowball tank items, you just don't get to free auto as a melee champ. There's a reason there's no melee carries in the league.
It's also just the kiting capacity of Kalista right here. Sticking within melee range on Kalista is very dependent on hitting your ult on Kalista, which is also, as it turns out, quite challenging to do.
He's going to be maxing the playful tricks to last, so the trademark high mobility isn't quite going to be there. So, look, he's gotten through the early game. He has the snowball kill. The Devourer purchase feeling a little bit better because it was completed at 10 minutes, but I don't really know how it's going to translate unless we're talking about six-item Fizz.
If he had not started to buy the Devourer before he got that first blood, I could see this working because that's an adaptation in the game. The fact that he already had the dagger before he got the first blood, that's what I call into question right here. Catch gonna try and take away this red buff. He is all alone.
Oh my goodness, Victor's gonna respond first as well. Has to flash away. The gravity field would have locked him up. Some of these decision-making, first the teleport we called into question, now just randomly walking to the enemy red buff when there's multiple members. Not like there's a lane swap on, he just wanted a red buff.
And not only that, but mid lane pushed up in favor of IM. Bottom lane, pushed up in favor of IM. They have so much time to respond here. And yeah, he gets out. Ignar comes up with an interrupt on the tunnel, and they're going to try and make a gank here. They think better of it as Tucson waiting in the tri-brush. But that is just a play you do not make as a jungler.
Look, it's a low percentage play at minimum, but maybe they're just taking a leaf from Anarchy's playbook, and it doesn't make a lot of sense, so who would expect it?
Well, when you're playing around jungle timers like that, though, that's a lot of disrespect for the enemy jungler, that they're not going to be there when their buff spawns, or at least close to it.
Tucson keeps farming the jungler. The farm jungler Fizz, not a title we expected to level at him, but maxing Seastone Trident, the big buffs are falling, and the stacks are coming.
And will it be Trinity Force next is the question. I bet you it will be. Going to deal some real on-hit damage there.
Uh-huh.
Interesting.
Oh,
Tucson. He tries very hard to be this big innovator. And to be fair to Tucson, he was. He was the one who pretty much got support Veigar nerfed. He was actually mostly responsible for that. He was the first one to play it here competitively.
Nothing will be more bizarre than the month of support Veigar, where he had no changes. And everyone was like, wait, Event Horizon's a pretty cool ability. And then they had to change it. Like, it's
Well, guess
surreal.
Whose fault that is? It's Tucson's. And Catch.
Wow.
Sneak it away.
Very alpha play from Catch.
I don't think he's very worried about this Fizz. Also, I really don't like junglers that can't buy Sightstone, Papa.
I could buy Sightstone, just be bad. Look at this, he's got the parts of a Sheen.
It's coming together.
The burst and the consistent, it's got everything. Burst, consistent damage, sticky. What's your issue with the Fizz?
Well, without Playful Trickster, he's just going to die instantly.
Yeah, that seems like a pretty big issue.
They have that lead, though. Frozen, aggressive here. There's the flash out. Tries to come in with the Death Ray, and that'll be a missed fish also.
It was a nice goal. Went straight between two opponents, so scored a goal, but doesn't actually get any potential value out of that pick. Frozen just keeps wave clearing. Spender, when they try and apply pressure, just it doesn't come together. That was four people committed to mid, and they got nothing out of it again.
Hey, they got both the Frozen Summoners.
He did have to Ghost Flash. I guess he probably could have just flashed, but
it could set up a possible repeat gank here, but yes, I think that the investment definitely not bearing a whole lot of fruit right now, especially as Ignar walks around with impunity, destroying all the tunnels. Starting to chase here. There's a hook down onto Ignar, and here's the response. Chilling Smite onto Ignar. There's the Alistar ultimate teleport coming in. Sasset in the back line gets exhausted, but the Chaos Storm ripping through. Catch gonna live, though, and that's gonna be a kill. Roar will just condemn out of the way, and there is a headbutt into the wall. Can Sasset actually get this kill? There is the Force Pulse to finish it off. Two for none off of that TP, and now Apple's TP back up.
Apple only had a flank ward. I believe he did have teleport available, but chose not to use it, which obviously caused a lot of chaos. When they were trying to create wards, they didn't have the wards down to really have a safe angle. Someone was going to fall instantly. That leads to a dragon, so the answering dragon, the answering kills, spend it back in this game.
Absolutely. Let's take a look at the replay here.
So Ignar actually holds onto the Unbreakable Will for a while. The teleport comes through. Maokai does have teleport available, chooses not to use it, thinking, okay, maybe only one person's going to fall. But the moment Frozen goes down, there should be at least a second kill. Ignar lives a long time. It was a very nice mini stun against the wall.
Yep.
Smart Alistar mechanics, but the heal's not going to be enough. And still, Apple's nowhere to be seen.
And that chain CC onto Victor prevented him from really doing anything besides ulting in that fight, which worked out very well because he couldn't use very many of his abilities within that choke point to help turn that fight around. So good engage at the very least.
And if we're going to criticize Spenu for their over going for those ganks that have low percentage chance of coming off, Frozen had just used his Ghost Flash, was in too aggressive a position, and was really preyed upon. So as you pointed out, getting those summoners actually proved very fruitful. And Apple, for whatever reason, we can't tell 100% whether he just called away or he just chose not to teleport, and Spenu reaped the benefit.
Absolutely. All right. Well, blue buff transferred over to Sasin right now. Sol going to catch the wave in the top sides. Tucson recalling calmly.
There's opting into late game, which is what you do when you pick a Kassadin, and there's a Kassadin going for Abyssal first, delaying the Rod of Ages till, at most optimistic, a 30-minute charge-up on that particular item. Probably not going to pick it up for at least a couple of minutes. Very fortunate that he was able to pick up some kills. Otherwise, the Rod of Ages might not even be able to be a consideration.
Yeah, you take a look at that, and you say that at least that kill and that assist probably accelerated by 2 to 3 minutes, which could make a big difference in this game as you try and race in terms of scaling against the Vayne.
Two evolutions of the Hex Core, so of course the QE is what we expected, the Death Ray and the Energy Transfer, I believe it's called, being augmented. What's your view on the perfect Hex Core? Do you just leave it to a fourth or fifth item, or is it a priority to pick it up earlier?
I think it depends on the composition, because if you have... Uh-oh, is Apple just going to walk away? Okay. We're going for the turret instead. I think it depends, because whether you actually upgrade the gravity field, as Roar will flash out of the way. Here's a TP, but Ignar not going to get anything right there. Fate's Call. Frozen finds himself in a very awkward situation. There's a stun and the follow-up slow, and there's the Q. Sasin takes the kill. Tucson on the outside. Chilling Smite, flash, and there is a Fizz ult. Just a disengage, so as I was saying previously, I think if you have follow-up CC or an initial CC that you could lay down the gravity field and then set up the AoE for, that it's worth it to upgrade just because you have that extra ability to create clumps for people. But I see it as more team comp focused.
Seems to be the call here. There's three members though. Vivid's caught out. This time there is no Fate's Call available, so Raw picks up a kill. His build's getting raw. He's not going for the pure duelist build in terms of picking up the Yomu's Ghostblade second. Probably going to be the Static Shiv, but has the flexibility of the Phantom Dance if he just wants to be the ultimate split pusher. I agree with your thing, but you can see with the Sheen, it's probably going to be the Lich Bane, much like Faker showed yesterday.
Well, just like Faker showed, though, there's a lot of melee on this Spenu team, which means that he's going to be able to trade very effectively, even around the short cooldown, or around the short cooldown and around the short range of that energy transfer, because Sol and Sasin have to get into his face to do damage, and even Kalista to a certain degree is similar in that way. So you can mitigate some of the burst by doing that and just trade super hard around your Q.
And the cute factor around the Q is that now a lot of the damage is backloaded, as Sasin's going to find Frozen, a huge burst of damage already. Sasin is actually just forced to move away, but of course half health is frozen. As I was mentioning, the damage is backloaded onto the auto attack, 0.5 AP ratio compared to, I believe, 0.2 on just the shielding part of the spell. Then with the Lich Bane, another 0.5 AP ratio, that's a 1 AP ratio auto attack after the defensive shield comes, so it's a lot of burst damage and of course gives you turret siege potential. Sarsen is feeling confident. The Rod of Ages is starting to stack up. It looks like 32 minutes that item will finally be completed. And the snowball kills, frozen twice, caught when he's trying to transition out of lane, is helping Sarsen weather what was quite a greedy item purchase of just delaying the Rod of Ages.
And also, Tucson's complete absence from this mid lane when Kassadin was vulnerable. And now he's going for that super big ticket item. In the Trinity Force, will he even ever make it there? Looks like Roar on the hunt right now. Soul is just going to get pinned to the wall and killed.
Very nice vein mechanics coming through. The only thing I can take away from the Fizz is some sort of split push, but split pushing with your smite and no global is just not really something you can do in competitive League of Legends. So many things you can do to take away from that strategy. Nuclear's going to keep pushing, probably going to pick up this bottom lane turret. Dragon in 25 seconds, but Longzhu IM don't seem interested in that objective right now. They haven't set up around the dragon at all.
Vayne just driving hard into the top side. Soul not up, but he will be, and he will have that TP soon enough. Apple still TP-less, so they're going to commit to trading turret for turret here and then move on from there into perhaps another objective somewhere else on the map. Do they go for that dragon? Looks like Roar just wants to put down that split-pushing pressure. And remember, part of that problem early in the game, Soul and Sassen opting into the magic resist. Now they have to deal with the split pushing Vayne while Soul has no arm guard, no armor, no way to stop the Vayne.
And it's already a really poor split push matchup. It's not the Hecarim that can deal with a Vayne in lane, it's the Rumble who's itemizing 14 fight damage. So they're able to pick up the dragon, but as you mentioned, it's a strategic hole that's being taken up here. Maybe when Sarsen finishes Azonius, he has some burst potential onto the Vayne, but the outplay potential is always there. Now with the Phage, Trinity Force or Black Cleaver are options for this Vayne.
And I really actually like both onto Vayne. I think it's just going to depend. I think that what is so great about Vayne these days with both of those items available is you can buy the Phage and you don't have to commit to a decision. If you happen to get a few kills and you go back with an epic amount of gold, go for the Trinity Force. But if you just want a little bit more durability or you happen to go back with a lesser amount of gold, then that Black Cleaver definitely an option against the Rumble and the Burst from the Kassadin as well. So a lot of, I like the build path now because it gives you some options on Vayne.
And honestly, it's kind of like an indirect buff to Phage, which is always one of the best items to build. Gives you health, gives you damage, makes your kiting and auto attacks and orb walking that much better. But it was kind of seen as a dead end item for Vayne because once you've committed to the Phage, you're like, okay, kind of need to get the Trinity Force to get a big power jump from this Phage. As you mentioned now, you are flexible. If you have an AD mid laner, Black Cleaver might be a realistic option. In this particular situation, where literally Vayne is the only source of physical damage, I'm expecting a Trinity Force, but if the 400 health is a consideration, has that option and flexibility.
All right, I am now making some moves around the Baron pit. They could do it quite quickly. There is that big threat. A couple of Sheens here, and the Blade of the Ruined King means that Svenu has to step carefully around the Baron pit. Can't leave it unattended for too long, or else it will be taken away from them.
Feels like Tucson hasn't increased in power since that first successful gank at 10 minutes. Merc treads the most expensive boots, slowly building into a Trinity Force, literally only having one part of that item completed. The power window of Fizz is those early ganks, and now going for the assassin build. I just don't know where this item, but where does the item build go next? Is it a frozen heart at 40 minutes into the game?
I am so incredibly skeptical of the success of this. If anything, I am is going to win this game in spite of this Fizz and not as a result of it, because with the one gank that he got in really hasn't justified the pickup whatsoever. He's now just looking for picks.
He can't pick the Kassadin.
No absolutely
chance
not.
Whatsoever. We're talking about base magic damage values that the Fizz is showing, not any sort of other values, of course, magic damage base. Now Soul is caught. Ignar hits the headbutt pulverize, gonna die. Baron's probably not a realistic objective, but on the other side,
Sarsen's
bottom
is.
with no teleport. Do they have a pink ward to clear out vision? Seems like the answer's no.
And no not very many sweeping lenses yet. If we take a look, IM has opted for
two warding totems.
Two warding totems, including one on the jungler, and not even a swap yet to a lens from Frozen. That is very late on a mid laner.
Honestly, it's lazy, I think, from the mid laner. Yeah. You have to change that much earlier or commit to a different
they
type
definitely
of
could have gone for the Baron right there had they had a sweeping lens onto Frozen. Of course, if it was up, that is the other factor.
And see, look, I've got an answer for you, Monte Cristo. You don't like Fizz because he can't build Sightstone? He can build Warding Totem. Yeah, showed you now.
You did. You got me, Papa Smithy.
Level 9 onwards, Sightstone for 250 gold. Think of the value.
I really don't like this pick.
You're really sad, aren't you?
Yeah, I am. I'm really sad right now. Tucson's just, he's just looking for another Vhagar. I understand. You got that success, Tucson.
So play Volibear.
Your pick. No, Diamond's already doing that. He can't be accountable for that any longer. Diamond's been doing that in the EULCS. Tucson just wants his moment in the spotlight.
You know what he should have done? He should have gone Maokai jungle.
Actually, legitimately an
option. Does exactly the same thing as Fizz. It's all about early pressure. You have the Twisted Advance, and then you had Fizz in the top against Rumble. It's not necessarily the best matchup, but you can win it with jungle pressure. And it's one thing Maokai can do, jungle pressure.
I think it's just functionally the same either way.
I mean, he builds a bit easy. Probably don't need to build the Devourer enchant on Maokai. You know, so would have baited him into a Frozen Heart at some point instead of what is going to be the world's latest Trinity Force from the jungle.
All right. Well, I am still trying to create picks right now, and they're actually sending Fizz deep into split push territory, thereby eliminating all pressure on the Baron because they do not have a smite at the Baron, so Spenu is going to be absolutely non-concerned with their ability to do it.
I have plenty of experience with this strategy. Week one of the LPL Spring, Riven jungle coming out from Spirit. Split pushing has a lot of merits in that Riven and Fizz can kill people. It's unfortunately a shame that the biggest strategical hole is the fact that you have no Baron pressure whatsoever.
As Fizz is going to take up a lot of farm if they do that as well, away from some of these carries that may provide a threat. And Frozen has actually decided to upgrade his warding totem here for absolutely no vision control from Incredible Miracle. The single sweeper that is still not an Oracle. Well, it is an Oracle's Lens, excuse me, from Ignar, so he's got that going for him.
Look, if you're going to split push with Fizz, if that's your strategy, then I think three warding totems makes sense. Go for the 1-3-1.
You have a Vayne.
I'm just saying.
Just split push
1-3-1, baby. Makes sense. Don't need to clear vision if you're never fighting for objectives, Monty.
Yeah, you bring up a valuable point. However, the Vayne is still grouped.
Fight starts. Fate's Call is used. Waiting for the Equalizer to come out. That's the big question. Neither of these teams want to commit to a fight. You can tell that from the totems that have been completed. The dragon's falling low.
Now, are they going to steal it? No, he gets knocked out of the pit. And now Roar with the ult on him. Sasin has to rift walk backwards. So dragon taken right there, but not stolen as Catch can't get an angle thanks to what was going on right there. Interesting fight. Spender just going to turn onto the mid lane instead.
All the pick ults were down, so they couldn't re-engage whatsoever. They'll take the outer turret, so we're even turrets. And we're at that awkward stage where it's two teams that don't show a lot of strength in late game shot calling. Super even at 31 minutes. No dragon advantage, no turret advantage. Some maybe potential scaling advantage, but honestly, that's pretty similar as well. And we could be in for a long game here, Monte Cristo.
I think we might be. There's the Righteous Glory going down. They want to make a pick. Some damage coming through from the Death Ray.
I don't mind that from Apple, just because if you look down at Kasten's build, no cooldown reduction. So although the little Rift Step is still at a 4-second cooldown at this point, was a little bit of a chance for an engage, but now that he's popped to level 16, cooldown reduction probably going to come out before too soon. Not going to see too many repeat engages onto Castle.
Well, and they're at least Spenu is starting to hit some good power spikes around these Zhonya's Hourglasses, which are going to change a lot in this game in terms of how Incredible Miracle can actually play with this Vayne and give Spenu more options to counterplay it.
Trinity Force completed from Raw. So speaking of power spikes, double Trinity Force. You know, we may joke about the fact that Tucson's is late, but now does have quite a lot of burst damage coming through. Lich Bane completed as well. That's three Sheen upgraded items completed basically at the same time.
Just do that Barret in 3 seconds flat, I am.
Between those three champions, we're just talking about Vayne with Blade of the Ruined King and Silver Bolts. They have massive Baron potential, but they need to all have pink wards. That's the big case. They put five pink wards down, okay. It's not the sweeping totem, but it's enough to be able to put on at least adequate Baron pressure.
Yeah, they're still trying to bait in something, finally getting the pink wards down. See if they can force it, but of course, there's Sentinels coming in. There's that Tremor Sense from Rek'Sai, so they can see pretty much everything that is happening in that river. It'll be hard for LZIM to actually deceive Spenu right here as Catch pops a ward into the pit, and that'll just be cleared up, but they've got the information they need.
I have a question for you, Monty. So the thing about baiting Baron against Rek'Sai, it's almost always fruitless. As Vivid might be engaging, eventually onto Ignar. Raw auto-attacking the backline, gets a lot of damage, as Sasa gets on top of him. Victor is dead as we're following the fight. Raw still alive, still fighting, but has no mid laner. Only one real threat available, but super low health values waiting for Raw. Stays alive so long, but falls down. Ignar's gonna fall as well. That's three clean kills from Spenu, and Tucson hop skips away, but isn't able to do anything.
No, doesn't do anything at all. Drops the ultimate, but that's about all he can contribute to that engagement. Question is, can he steal now? As the Baron is looking like it will be in Spenu's hand, but that Kalista going to make it awfully difficult to get in there and actually make a play onto this objective. They see Tucson on the outside, and they're just gonna burn this down. Kalista's there, there's a smite, there's a rend. And there's a Baron for Spenu Sonic Boom.
They fought really well. They're gonna pick up Vivid on the backside as Tucson. You're not gonna be able to lock down this Viz. Actually, they are.
Welcome to the Zhonya's power spike. That's gonna be about it.
But the Trinity Force helped him kill one person. And then he didn't have any levels in this Playful Trickster and died.
Yeah, it's a great investment of several thousand gold.
3,700.
At least it was less than 4K. So he only needs to get, what, another 10, 11 kills to pay for that one?
Well, I mean, look, one's more than 10. One's less than 10, but it's getting there. So what's your take on this fight?
Frozen getting locked down immediately by the depth charge. It's a good chain right into the Rumble ultimate right there. But, I mean, the fact of the matter is the jungler is just completely out of this fight already. There's no peel for the backline when it goes through because there's just simply insufficient CC on Fizz to actually draw that pressure away, and he's not a damage threat. So essentially, Spenu's just able to just sprint into that fight, use the equalizer on the back line, catch up, and annihilate the carries.
I can kind of understand where IM were coming from. They had Maokai and Alistar already a lot of peel between those two picks, so he went for a backline threat. It's just that Tucson, I feel like building full tank, he would have occupied more of Kalista's time than he's able to with this damage build.
Yeah.
It sounds counterintuitive.
I still think that they should have picked Evelynn.
Yeah, that probably would have solved the problem. Spenu pushing in. They don't have a strong siege. In fact, there's three melee champions and a Kalista with strong attack speed, but it's enough to take down the objective. The wave clear coming through from only Frozen. It's going to do so much, only so much on the IM side. They're going to rotate bottom, and I feel like IM might need to fight, but I don't know how they win a fight against a Kassian who's basically free-farmed his way to 500 AP.
Yep, and they keep on pressing forward as well. They've got that big shield for the Bloodthirster, so this Kalista does have some freedom just to walk up on these turrets and get some autos off. Sasan going to Rift Walk out of harm's way. They're just sitting there with the empowered minion wave right now, waiting for the next one. Meanwhile, Kassadin is on duty to push the super minion waves all the way through and start accelerating the siege pressure that the rest of his team can put on. It's the first super minion going to be coming out with this very next wave.
Wait to see Spenu just backing away. Dragons available. This will be their third dragon. Dragon not really a win condition, at least at present. It's only going to be a third Dragon for them at 36 minutes. We're guessing the game's probably not going to go 50, though there's always the potential of that happening. Crucially, Spenu haven't really organized a map movement that gets them this last outer turret in the top lane. So that's probably going to be their next port of call. They haven't traditionally been the best team at prepping these side wind minion waves, so no surprise that they just kind of haven't really picked up that strategic hold just yet. But they're going to send Rumble top, go buy some items. Going to be the death cap, I guess, coming through from Sassen. Honestly, the Lich Bane might be worth considering just for a bit more turret damage because they're very short range. It's four melee champions and a Kalista.
Yeah, I don't know if that's worthwhile. I think you just go for the dive here instead of hoping that you're going to get some Lich Bane procs off on your Kassadin, because you can really commit to that on the follow-up from an Equalizer, and that burst is going to be much more valuable in my mind.
I think it's kind of a line ball, just that Kassadin's so maneuverable with a 2-second Rift Warp that it's very easy to get cute, feign aggression, get a Lich Bane proc, get out again. And Lich Bane, of course, gives you burst as well. The damage value is probably a bit of a line ball between the two. Death Cap's fine. It'll give them a bit more AoE wave clear, a bit more AoE burst. And if it opens up a Ren set for the Kalista, it's very valid.
All right. Well, still having some hard time putting more pressure on. It's like the Baron buff no longer going to be a factor.
Just falls off now.
Yeah, in Spenu's Siege, so that's one less thing that IM has to worry against. They don't have the best wave clear right now, but the one thing that really surprises me about this game is IM's lack of split push with Vayne. Spenu didn't really have any tools at a certain point in this game to deal with it. Roar was doing quite well for himself, and now it is just completely absent.
Yeah, they maneuvered him top lane. It was looking good. He was working on his Trinity Force, but the power spike, we didn't even mention, they got those three Sheen items and lost a fight and a Baron. Now that power spike's being weathered to a great extent from champions like Catch, who's picked up the Randuin's. They're getting tanky. Zhonya's QSS all available. They're still going to struggle to break the base. We always like to talk about breaking the base as a tipping point. Four melee champions, unless they can engineer one of these split pushes or these global minion wave pushes that they've never been their strong point, Spenu breaking the base could be super difficult.
Yeah, and they don't have that split pushing edge either. As long as the Vayne is here, they are going to find themselves having problems. Yes, they can chip away these turrets if it's just the Vayne defending. No static shift, no real wave clear, but the extended defense of the 1v1, effectively, Spenu have to dive. They have to get an angle on the back of this tier 2 with the Kassadin, or else there's going to be a risk of another big Baron fight taking place. And if we see a lot of 50-50s in Barons in this game, who the hell knows who's going to win?
Super curious lack of an Aegis coming through from IM. I guess you have that Fizz, so you kind of pigeonhole yourself into building damage, but the Aegis is so necessary. In fact, instead of a Locket, I would actually prefer to see the other option come through, just to give magic resistance to one of the minions and stop the pushing even further. Force only Kalista to be the person. When it comes to Sieges, Apple's caught super tanky, but with four members, nobody's tanky enough. They finally get the pick. Apple's low. He might survive.
Yeah, it looks like this is going to be turned around just a little bit. Tucson hopping in and out. Catch low thanks to the Chaos Storm. No kills, though.
You would think someone would not be tanky enough to last to the ire of four members of Spenu. That should have been the turret they were looking for, but good defense coming through from his team. Apple, obviously a tanky god at this point with 200 resist plus coming through, and they don't get the catch, and crucially, don't even break that last outer turret.
And they also have to recall, so Spenu losing a bit of positioning over the Baron right here. Here's the clear from IM. So they move in on towards that objective, and they get quite a few wards placed and prepped down there. Still all their inhibitor turrets standing, so they're in relatively good shape at the moment, not really under any kind of fire from a large number of dragon stacks right now.
So where have I seen this before? A pick comp gets to the late game, falls behind, the enemy team can't quite finish, and despite the fact that they have a pick comp, they take the game. Honestly, I am a role reverse with KT. It feels like we're getting back to the stage of that infamous 50-plus minute game that we had last week. And if Spenu make a mistake and lose Baron, there's a very realistic chance that IM run over and win this game.
Yes, that is definitely true, especially with like you're saying, the Trinity Forces, the Lichbane,
structure
LZIM
damage.
Is going to be able to instantly chew through the base of Spenu, and they don't have enough towers left to actually protect themselves effectively if they find themselves too far behind here. They still want to go for this bear. They still have the Callista.
Every minute that Spenu doesn't close out this game is another second on the death timers in the late game. Execution in late game teamfights hasn't been Spenu's strength. You make one mistake and you get rolled by the triple Sheen items, as we mentioned. You can see a fight over this blue buff. Baron's respawned. The fourth dragon for Spenu is coming through soon. Tremorsense giving them a lot of information, but this whole time, Sol's actually split pushing in the bottom lane. This is something we haven't seen from Spenu, but so far it's been unanswered.
And this Vayne, no movement over there as well. She can't leave right now while the Baron is being under threat.
Maokai teleports back in. IM need to fight. Sol has options here. It won't break the base. They're going to fight, though. They force the teleport. Fate's Call used defensively. We're waiting to see why Rumble Equalizer comes down.
And there it is, Equalizer in the back line. Tucson getting knocked up by the Nautilus Ultimate. Sol running through. Frozen fleeing for his life right now. He will go down. Nuclear finds a way around the edge of the fight. Apple is here. He's very tanky, but even he's not tanky enough to resist that double kill for Nuclear as they trade two for two.
Nuclear.
And now there's a void.
Nuclear played such a dangerous game, staying on the outside of the fight. They're trying to chase onto Roar, who's super fast with the Trinity Force, though.
Now, honestly, I don't know why Sol even TP's into that fight. You don't have to do that. He was going to get that inhibitor turret 100%. And Vivid, who is ostensibly caught out right there, was just pulled right away with the Fate's Call. There wasn't any more engaged. Spenu was in the clear with that. If we look at what happens, so Vivid comes out. Ketch has a tunnel. He just tunnels out. Sassen is playing Kassadin.
But Nuclear is so smart. Look, he still hasn't committed this fight. You might think, okay, that's a problem. He's not doing damage. There's a few autos. Gets punted out. But that buys him time to get distracted from the Fizz and all the other threats. So when he actually enters the fight, it's to assassinate Frozen in the back line.
Yeah, he does make the big arc. But I really think that Spenu had no reason to fight that. They had gotten the teleport out of Apple's Maokai. They had the pressure on the bottom side. They had already successfully disengaged and could choose at any time to come in and teamfight that if the Baron was done by IM. Otherwise, they lose at least an inhibitor turret right there, which is already down to 50%, and maybe the inhibitor itself. So really disagree with Spenu's shot calling in that situation.
It's such a high-pressure environment. Making a clear call when there's a threat of Baron coming down, you can understand why a newer team would struggle in that sort of environment. So it looked like it was too much of a risk from Apple to commit everything. Remember, he basically gave up any hope of fighting that inhibitor turret down bottom. But it paid off. So going for the assertive move, it's what we talked about. It's something we wanted to see out of these teams. An assertive move, maybe too assertive from Apple, did pay off for IM.
Yeah, now they're waiting around this Baron once again. IM really wants that. Catch going to be the designated split pusher right here as he carves his way through a minion wave. He's got that void rush, but not a lot of good tunnels. Just one behind the Baron on that top side.
Poke damage from Sassen, super high. It's an excellent place to fight with the Equalizer, but they're forced to back away. Catch, of course, makes a lot of sense, as you mentioned, has the ability to be involved in a fight. The turret's probably back up to about a third health after being chipped out. LZIM are just starting this Baron, and Rek'Sai's coming through. Can they just rush it down?
The Equalizer comes in. There's the hook from Vivid. Catch going to take the long tunnel and a huge, huge knock-up. Holy cow, that is a lot of work. Roar gets targeted down. Sassen just going crazy right here for a triple. And there is Tucson trying to hide.
What?
Okay, well, looks like IM just going to walk right past, try and push into the base right now, finally get that inhibitor down that they've had their eye on
and spend
for
it,
a lot of this game. But, man, that was a massive knockup from the Nautilus ult.
The Fate's Call was huge. I believe it was an instant melee range ultimate as well. A double knockup, the wombo that came through. It wasn't quite Hurricane Callista, but it didn't matter. In this situation, they're trying to finish, still 30-second death timers on all the threats.
Yep, and looks like they will be able to. Tucson stance, no chance, dies to the ignite. Sassen, another kill for him, and this will be Spenu's first game win of the season coming through at 46 minutes.
A historic win for Spenu. They played very smartly in two massive fights that decided the game. First, Ayan made that over-engage. We thought it would be a problem for Seoul teleporting in, but it paid off in the end as Calista cleaned it up. Then another smart fight wins them the game. The power spikes looked like they were there for Ayan, but Spenu, smart team fighting, the Kassadin massive, got through the laning phase very safely, was probably the big difference.
And you have to wonder if Ayan had had a not Fizz jungle, if they would have been able to take home some of those team fights, because that Fizz was essentially useless with that Devour enchantment in that game.
I mean, it's an awful build, Monte Cristo. Trinity Force, Devourer, Spirit Visage, Giant Spell. What does that even do? It's not even a Banshee Veil to stop some of the peel coming through.
I actually thought it was going to be a Veil when we saw the Cowl.
Nope.
But